So let me introduce Carly Shuler, who's a researcher, developer, and author in the children's media and toy industry. She was the inaugural fellow of the Joan Ganz Cooney Center Accessibility Workshop, which she will tell you briefly about. And for them, she researched and authored a number of reports, including D is for Digital and iLearn. Her fellowship has ended, but she's still continuing to work with the center. She's leading many of their industry initiatives with a focus on consumer trends, informal learning, and mobile devices. And she brings to this a background that's included positions at Sesame Workshop and also a spin master. She wrote in her bio that she tweets, blogs, and speaks, which I thought actually sounded like the next generation of Mattel dolls. follows the magic of what's going on in our industry today.
Thanks. I also include airplane. So, hi everybody. So nice to be here and see you all. So I just want to start, before I dive into the results of a really, really new report that we are releasing this afternoon, so I'm so excited to be sharing new data. I want to tell you about something. How many times have you heard in the last few days at CES, I'm going to show you a device that you've never heard before with features that you've never seen? Probably one or two. Well, I am really going to show you something that I promise you have never seen. It's called an iPogo, and I've invited one of my friends to help me share. Okay, let's start.
Yes, my friends! Hey, the iPogo can do anything!
Anything?
Oh, yeah!
If you want to comb your cat, there's an app for that. If you have to fix a flat, there's an app for that. Need a word that rhymes with that? Or a place to hang your hat? Got a chimp who likes to chat. There's an app for that. If your butter needs a pat, there's an app for that. If you need to rat-a-tat-tat,
there's an app for that.
You gotta practice singing scat. Wanna meet a boy named Matt?
Hi, I'm Matt. Nice to meet you.
Count to 10 in no time flat.
Obviously, there's so many devices out there, and there are apps for many different things. So what I'm going to talk to you about a little bit today is a snapshot of this dynamic children's digital media market with a focus on apps. But let me start by telling you a little bit about the organization that I come from. So in 1969, a woman named Joan Ganz Cooney asked a question: how can emerging media help children learn? She was an independent television producer. And her answer to that question was a television show called Sesame Street. So it's now over 40 years later, and although the mediums that children are consuming are drastically different, the question, how can emerging media help children learn, remains just as relevant, if not more relevant today, as it did when Mrs. Cooney answered that original question. So I work for an organization named in her honor called the Joan Ganz Cooney Center at Sesame Workshop. So we're housed at Sesame Workshop, the creators of Sesame Street, but we are an independent organization, and we really aim to answer this question in a digital age and further the field of children's learning through digital media. So we do that in a number of ways, one of which is releases a number of reports that help inform the field. So almost three years ago, we probed something that David referred to called the passback effect. And so what happened was we started to notice anecdotally on the subway, on the streets, that kids were using their parents' devices, namely at the time iPhones and iPod touches and even iPods. And this is actually pretty interesting because parents' devices have always been amongst kids' favorite toys. So if you look at things like a toy vacuum cleaner, a toy phone, that aspirational play pattern has been common for decades, but for the first time, kids were actually playing with the real thing. And so that was really interesting. And again, this was just 2.5 years ago, and there was still, it's hard to believe sitting in this room today, but people were still sort of like, are parents really gonna let their kids play with an iPhone? You know, an iPad wasn't even in our vernacular yet. So, you know, people were doubtful of that. So to answer that question and to figure out ourselves at the Cooney Center if we needed to be diving into this market, we published a very small study. It was called iLearn, and what it was we looked at the top 100 selling paid apps in the education section of iTunes, just to see, you know, how many of them targeted kids. And what we found was pretty shocking. We found, this was in 2009, that over 50% of the top paid apps in the education section of iTunes targeted kids. So this was extremely eye-opening to us, and I think to the field, that there was something to come here in terms of kids and apps and tablet devices and mobile phones. And obviously sitting here today, that seemed to be, that premonition has seemed to come true. So it's now 2 years later, and we've updated that original report. So we're releasing iLearn 2 today, this afternoon, as soon as I finish making the final edits. And so it's an analysis of the top-selling paid apps in the education section of iTunes. So again, it's really important to note that this is just one slice of the dynamic kids' digital media field. You know, of course, there's not only paid apps, there's free apps, and there's in-app purchases, and there's not only educational category, there's games. And then there's certainly not only Apple, there's Android, and then there's Leapfrog, and then there's the Da Vinci, and the, you know, there, you can go on and on and on. And you know, in terms of kids' media consumption, there's another thing, maybe you've heard of it, called television. So obviously this is just one slice of a market, but it's a very important slice, with the iPhone, iPad, and iPod Touch topping out kids' holiday wish list this past holiday season. This seemed to be an important one to look at. So we looked at the top-selling apps, and we analyzed them by a number of different factors, including age and price. And I'm just going to get into a few of the results for you right now. Again, this full report will be released later, and we're around to ask questions afterwards. So let me dive in and share some things that are really interesting. So this slide, this is 2009. So in 2009, what we found was 45% of the apps, of the top-selling paid apps, targeted toddler and preschool children. Again, this is all within the education category of iTunes. So if you add all those numbers up, it turned out that over 50% of the apps targeted children of all ages. And the numbers can add up to over 100% because an app could be tagged for more than one age group. So this was shocking to us at the time. Let's look at what's happened in the last 2 years. So the blue bar represents 2011. Huh. So as you can see, looking at all the children's categories ranging from toddler, preschool, all the way until high school, the percentage of apps that target children has risen in every single age category, with a corresponding decrease in the percentage of apps that target adults. So if anyone is still questioning whether this is an important and growing market, I think that this can take that question right away. So this is a really interesting finding, and let me take a minute to explain it to you, because I think this is actually one of the most interesting findings that we had. This chart compares the overall sample, which is in the light blue, to the top 25, which is in the green. And so you can see it's split out by age group here. And what we see is that toddler preschool is overall the most popular age category, both amongst the overall sample and the top 25 bestsellers, which I think if you're in the marketplace, that's not entirely surprising. For apps and for children's media in general, there has always been a particular prominence of media targeting young children. What's really exciting here is that if you look at the top 25, elementary age kids are overrepresented amongst the best sellers. So what that means is that amongst the best sellers of the best sellers, elementary kids are being particularly well served, which is really interesting. One of the most interesting things about this slide is that if you look at this in our 2009 study, it was toddler and preschool demographic that saw the overrepresentation amongst bestsellers. So if you look at what's happened in the last 2 years, that did seem to be somewhat of a premonition of what was to come, because that group saw the greatest growth. So what I would say about this slide is that if I was a developer, I would be paying very close attention to elementary school kids and the role that these devices may play in their digital media landscape and in their learning. So we also, in addition to age, we also looked at the apps by price, and what we found was extremely interesting. So you've got 2009 on the left and 2011 on the right, and the average price of children's apps has risen from $1.13 in 2009 to $2.14 in 2011. So the average price of children's apps has risen by just over a dollar, which is a fairly substantive increase when you think about the average price of these apps. I mean, that's a pretty big jump. the price of adult apps has increased as well, but not as significantly. So I think that something that I hope we talk about after this panel is the business models that are emerging in the app world. And you know, I hope developers aren't just defaulting to the 99 cent price point, because if you create something magical but it's not sustainable, then it's never going to make it into the hands of kids. So we need to wrap our heads around business models and figure out what direction they can take to create a sustainable marketplace. And the fact that the average price of children's apps in the bestsellers has risen by over a dollar shows that consumers are willing to embrace these different pricing models. So again, looking a little bit at pricing, most children's apps are 99 cents or $1.99. So, but what's interesting here is you can see that 36% are 99 cents and 38% are $1.99. So in 2009, 88% of the apps were 99 cents. So that accounts for that increase by over a dollar. I don't know, are there a lot of apps out there that are priced significantly higher and parents aren't buying them, or are there not many apps that are priced higher? That's something that this analysis can't tell us. But again, there needs to be ongoing conversation around business models. And you know, because of the marketplace, this will all fall out, but it looks like people who are pricing their apps a little bit higher, and isn't it funny that $1.99 is higher, are seem to be succeeding. So we also looked at school usage. So we tagged the apps for whether they mentioned any sort of institutional or school usage in their app description. And what we found was interesting. We found that 14% of apps mentioned school usage. So at first I thought, oh, only 14% of the apps mentioned school usage. And then I thought, oh, 14% of the apps mentioned school usage. So I don't really know how to interpret this slide, but I think there is going to be a growing market for apps for institutional markets. And there's a call-out box in the paper that talks about this and talks about an organization called Brainpop. I don't know if any of them are here, and their entryway to the app market. And if I were a developer, I would definitely be paying attention to institutional market as well as informal learning markets and game markets. And what's neat about these devices is they can really bridge that gap. And for so long, there's been such a huge gap between what happens when kids enter the school and what happens when they leave. And I think that there's a great opportunity here to bridge this gap. And we can talk about it after, but I can even name a few examples of apps that seem to be living in both worlds, which hasn't really happened in media before. So it's very exciting. So another thing that we tagged for was branding. So what this means was we looked for apps that were based on a popular mainstream branded character from another medium. So was there Dora, was there Elmo, was there somebody that kids would know about? So even if a developer had branding within their app that they created themselves, that was not tagged as branded, even though it would be branded, but it's a little bit confusing. But what we found was actually shocking, which was that only two of the iPhone apps and none of the iPad apps were based on branded characters. This was my personal biggest surprise from doing this analysis. And so we thought, what's going on here? Where are all the branded kids apps? So if you look, and remember, we were looking at the education category of the game section. Education category of iTunes. If you look at the games category, and this is just a quick glance at the top 12 apps on a given day, you can see that half of them were based on popular mainstream branded characters. So I did interview a few people for the report around this issue of licensing and branding in an app world. And again, oh, this is all really falling out. But I think that there is a great opportunity for independent developers to partner with mainstream, you know, content providers. So why can't a Toontastic or a Motion Map partner with a Sesame or Disney and help solve this discovery problem that so many app developers have, which is how do people find me on the App Store? And that can help bring them in. So there's a lot of opportunity there. And one last quick thing, within the sample of 200 apps, 109 publishers were represented. 7 publishers had 5 or more apps. And 89 publishers were not represented in our 2009 sample. So if you just compare these numbers to something that you would see at, you know, in the video game industry or in the toy industry, this shows the low barriers of entry to this market. It shows the staggering uniqueness of this market as compared to other elements of the kids' digital media world. And this is pretty exciting for people looking to jump in here. So the report also includes some expert interviews that probe some of the issues that I've talked about, ranging from discovery and sustainability to the institutional market, efficacy, the research that's needed, and it also includes some recommendations for developers and policymakers and academia, and we're releasing it this afternoon, so we're really excited, and I think I'm out of time. So thanks very much.